have to continue. So, very warm welcome to this event, which is commemorating the 700th anniversary of the death of Dante. This presentation will be given by Professor Emeritus Joseph Lo Bianco from the University of Melbourne. My name is Associate Professor Anna Sullivan, and I'm the Director of the Research Centre, known as the Centre for Research in Educational and Social Inclusion at the University of South Australia. Our research centre focuses on contributing new knowledge about issues related to education and social inclusion. I'm very pleased to be chairing this seminar on Dante and Italian language during Italian Language Week. I'd like to open this webinar by acknowledging that the land that I meet on today and some of my colleagues is the traditional lands of the Kaurna people, and I pay my respects to elders past and present. We pay our respects to their connections to land, sea and community. I'd also like to acknowledge the First Peoples and the traditional owners and custodians of the country where each of you are meeting and linking into this webinar from. First of all, I'd like to introduce you to the Consul of Italy in Adelaide, Dr. Adriano Stendardo. Over to you, Adriano.
Thank you so much, Anna. It is a great pleasure for me to be part of this opening event of the Italian Language Week. I'm grateful to the Center for Education and Social Inclusion of UniSA for this opportunity, and to all of you who are participating in this seminar, which I think it will be a great way to kick off the week, together with the Professor Emeritus Joseph Lo Bianco of the University of Melbourne. I really don't want to take too much time out of the presentation, just to give you a little bit of context regarding this initiative, the Italian Language in the World. It's an event which has been launched way back in 2001 by the Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And throughout the years, it has become one of the most important initiatives in the Italian international calendar. And you know, since its early establishment, it's been implemented with the high patronage of the presidency of the Republic. One interesting piece of information is that every year, the week has had a specific theme, an overarching focus. For instance, in 2015, the Italian Language Week was centered around music. In 2016, on design and fashion. In 2017, on film and movies. But this year, it's particularly important, significant to all Italian and Italian speakers all around the world, because the 2021 week, as you mentioned, Anna, is been formally dedicated to the 700th anniversary of the death of Dante Alighieri. And for this reason, the entire Italian diplomatic network is celebrating this anniversary with a lot of initiative all around the world. So I invite you to follow the consulate website, but not only the Italian consulate, the website and the social network of the diplomatic Italian network all around the world, in particular in Australia, to be updated with the latest news regarding all the initiatives which are going to be programmed throughout the week. So again, I'm really, really thankful to Professor Lo Bianco for being part of this initiative, to the Center for promoting this event together with Italian Consulate. And I'm really looking forward to hear the presentation by the professor dedicated to the anniversary of Dante Alighieri. So Anna, thank you again for your kind introduction. And without further ado, I will give back the floor to you. Once again, grazie mille and benvenuti a tutti.
Grazie. And now I'll introduce you to Dr. Enza Tudini.
Thanks, Anna. I'm Program Director for Languages and Languages and Coordinator of the Italian Program at the University of South Australia. And in the spirit of Italian Language Week, I thought I should acknowledge country in Italian. Riconosciamo i custodi tradizionali delle terre del popolo Garna e dei popoli dei territori di tutta l'Australia da cui siete collegati. Riconosciamo il loro legame con la terra, l'acqua e le comunità. Rendiamo omaggio ai loro anziani, passati e presenti. So, Professor Lo Bianco needs no introduction, but I should just make a few points about his extraordinary contribution to language and languages policy in Australia. He wrote Australia's National Policy on Languages in 1987, the first multilingual national language policy in an English-speaking country. And he was the chief executive of the National Languages and Literacy Institute of Australia until 2002. He's a specialist in language policy studies and in the practical formulation of effective language policy. He has also written extensively about Italian in Australia and its future. In this presentation entitled, What Can Italian Teaching Learn from Dante, Not as a Poet, but as the World's First Language Planner, Professor Lo Bianco will provide a new perspective on the foundational poet of Italian in Italy, Dante Alighieri. He will discuss the significance of De Vulgari Eloquentia, a Latin text that Dante wrote proposing the development of a national language as part of the process of national unification. Professor Lo Bianco will argue today that in De Vulgari Eloquentia, Dante established himself as possibly the first serious theoriser of how language change occurs, how vernaculars can be developed, and how multilingualism functions. Thank you. And now I'll, Joe, you can take the floor.
Thank you very much. I want to thank Professor Sullivan and Il Console and you, Enzo, very kindly for facilitating all this and for the initial invitation, and to all the participants from different places for your interest. It seems like we've resolved the question of the screen share, so I'll just attend to that and then I'll get started. I trust people can see that well enough. Okay. And you can hear me properly? Is that true, Enza? Okay, assuming that's the case. Oh. Okay, so I'm going to be talking about something that's a bit unusual for me, because I'm not a literary scholar and I'm not really focused on poetics or any of the things that Dante has famously done. I'm actually more concerned with language policy and planning in social situations, such as in Australia and in some places abroad. But Dante's influence is so important that I thought that after being invited to give this lecture, that I would focus on an aspect of his work that is not very well known. I'll describe that as I proceed. I've got a message that you can hear me. And this is the work that's encased in what's called a minor prose work. In other words, not a poem and not one of his major works. And it's called De Vulgari Eloquentia. And immediately you can see that it's not in Italian. He actually wrote this in Latin. Now, he's, of course, considered the father of the language of Italian, so this is odd that he wrote this work, but he did write some works in Latin. So there's an interesting story to tell about the choice of language, and I'll make a mention of that a bit later. I particularly like this photo I'll see if you can remember what I might be interested in here. Give you a hint, it's about translation and dictionaries. Here we go. Okay, my copy looks like the one that's on my left, which is pretty unattractive. Translation by Stephen Bottrell, which I have, which I purchased about 10 years ago in London. And I was astonished when I read it. I actually bought it on a whim. I didn't really know that it would tell me what it does tell me and what I'm going to talk about a bit later. The more beautiful copies on the right of my screen are what I'd like to own, which are these Italian and Latin versions that are very precious and that I've seen in bookshops in Rome at eye-watering prices. But mine looks on the left like the one on the left, and the content is the same. So as you will see here, il mio talk oggi is going to offer cenni e spunti on the progettazione linguistica of Italy's foundational poet Dante Alighieri, e allo stesso tempo discuss no poetry. What I'm doing there is playing with a bit of linguistic translanguaging, fusing different languages, but I'm also performing a game, which I think is something that I hope you will see as we proceed through the talk, that I think even the illustrious Dante himself used. And I'm also complaining. I'm complaining about the use of too much English in the text these days. So my talk today is basically going to focus on a description of this work, De Vulgari Eloquentia, which I'm going to call DVE. I'm going to talk about language policy and planning, what it's all about, and what did Dante contribute to it. I think this is really not very well known by people who study language planning. I've published two things about this already, but I need to do, I think I want to do a more substantial work defending his role in this because it's not very well recognized. And then I'm going to talk about Italian in Australia today. Now the links between DVE and Italian in Australia today are pretty stretched, but I'll try and make some connections that are useful. And then I'm going to draw a lesson or three for teaching and for the promotion of the language here. Okay, this would be like the curriculum vitae of Dante's work. As you can see, it's about 3, 6, 9 significant works, mostly in Italian, but there are 2, 3 in Latin. The De Vulgari Eloquentia comes in 1302 to 1305, just after he's been exiled from his beloved Florence. But in fact, it's a far from complete work. It was meant to be 4 books. I'll describe it in a few minutes. But only half of that was completed, or less actually than half. And I'm only going to focus on the first book. All of the other works, however, tell us something about how to interpret De Vulgari Eloquentia. And I want to say at the beginning, I'm not a literary scholar, as I mentioned at the also at the beginning. I don't focus on poetry, so I'm really focusing on what the messages there are for language planning and policy, which I will explain in a few minutes. Now, Dante's esteem and prestige in the world, a lot of it comes from his reception in England, in fact, among poets, like, for example, these comments from T.S. Eliot: Dante and Shakespeare divide the world between them. There is no third. If you read T.S. Eliot's wonderful work, it's full of praise and admiration for Dante. Not even just praise and admiration, but actually incorporation of the concepts and work and phrases in The Wasteland. He's got these direct quotes from Purgatorio, from Inferno, from other parts of Dante's work. So he was a clear admirer of Dante's poetry, and helped establish, although by this stage in the 1950s, it was well and truly recognized, the translation of the Divine Comedy that I like the best is the one done by Dorothy Sayers, which she wrote during the Blitz in London during the Second World War, as bombers were crashing down on the city. But there are many, many translations in English, partly because it's so difficult to actually translate. I hope you can see this. Part of the screen is hidden for me. But it's not that Dante that I'm focusing on here, that is T.S. Eliot's Dante. I'm focusing not on the poet's poet, but the language planner's poet. And this book, the DVE, which, as I said, was intended to be four books and ends halfway through the second one and was never finished. Book two starts out as an analysis of the Sicilian canzoni, the main genre or type of Sicilian poetry, but that stops at chapter 14. And Dante is looking to find which kind of literary expression best suits vernacular languages. Now, vernacular languages means basically, in Europe at this time, everything other than Latin. But he's a proud Tuscan, and yet he says the first 150 years of Italian poetry was written in Sicilian. Now, from a Southern perspective, this is a really interesting comment. I mean, we know that Sicily was a great hothouse of literary production generally, but Dante, who's associated so much with Tuscany, makes this comment and makes other praises in this book for Sicily. Book three and four, we think, from what he says in book one and half of book two, were going to be about comedy and tragedy, but we will never know because he never wrote them, or he either did write, they were lost. What's distinctive about the DVE is the focus on the vernacular in a literary work. It's a work of what we would call poetics. He's trying to find the right way to express different languages in poetic and literary form as a technical discussion. And yet within it, there's this political element of what to do about Italian disunity. Remember, it's a country divided in multiple states at the time. There have been multiple invasions from the north. And he wants to help unify this state. And in doing this, he recognizes or feels like one of the things that holds back the unity of the country is not having a language between transnational Latin, that is Latin above all the nations, and subnational dialects, usually at the city level. It's a very interesting text. He's got lots of interesting and judgmental views about language, but he sees language in some ways that are very contemporary today, as very dynamic and contextualized, meaning he sees it varying according to context, linked to identity and highly changeable. So he's looking at all of Europe, and in fact, all of the world, and his desire and search for what he calls the illustrious vernacular, a vernacular that you can be really proud of, that will bring light and education to people for a state that he calls Italy, but which doesn't exist. It's just a geographic and cultural entity. In the course of this, he discusses how languages come about. He says some pretty weird things about the Garden of Eden and how even though Eve actually spoke first, it really was Adam, because you couldn't have a woman being the first person to speak. And so he's got a bit of sexism in there. He then looks at world geography, especially Europe, and he sees three basic entities, Greek to the east, Germanic to the north, within which he includes Magyar, the Hungarian speech zone, and Slavonic languages. And then in the south, where he puts most of his attention. And in the south, he sees three Romance languages, areas rather, and these are according to how they say yes. So, you know, the languages of Oc, Oil, and Si. And he's very interested in this through works that have come through the poetry of the Occitan troubadours, Catalan ones mainly, but also in the south of France. So his main texts are Latin, Sicilian, and Italian sources, the work of his teacher, Brunetto Latini, who was an Aristotelian specialist and a philosopher. And these are his sources. So he's read reasonably widely for someone at this time. And the other, what he calls the locutio secondaria, the secondary language, and it's very important to think about how he talks about the dialects as the locutio primaria, the primary languages. So locutio secondaria is grammatica, that is the high Latin the formal educated speech of the intellectual classes at all the universities in Europe at the time, and the production of science everywhere. So basically this transnational educated standardized form of language, which he doesn't ever want to undermine, but he sees it as not dynamic because it's totally text-based, not organic, and it's not natural like the vernaculars. He sees it as a set of rules and dogmas. And this is where I think he really is starting to get quite radical. And then once he's done all this, he does something really remarkable, which is why I actually bought the book in that bookshop in London many years ago. Because between chapters 10 and 15 of book one, and I have to explain, a chapter is really not very long. We're not dealing with the chapters of a conventional book today. It becomes like a travelogue of cities and towns and states. And he describes it as a hunt. And he's hunting for the most illustrious dialect, the most illustrious vernacular. And he goes in and he sees one in Modena, and he describes one here and another one in Trento and another one in another place. And he judges them. You know, this is a good one, this is not so good one. It has these qualities and those qualities. And he identifies 14. So this, the Dante that emerges from the DVE is a really different person from the poet. Self-aware, although he is certainly self-aware in the poetry, occasionally self-congratulating himself, self-congratulatory. And what's really interesting is that the patriotism that's very clear, his great love of his city, is also tied to this imagined united country that he wants to protect from foreign invasions, which keep happening. He's often censorious and judgmental. But what's really interesting is he's talking about this imagined community. How does he imagine this community will come about? To me, it reads a lot like the great American anthropologist Benedict Anderson's idea of the United States as an imagined community, an entity so large that people can't possibly know each other and can't have bonds of community with each other. They imagine themselves living together as co-citizens. I think Dante prefigures some of this in the DVE. He also says that it can't really exist because it doesn't have a language. France is united under a monarchy, so is Germany. He means the Holy Roman Empire there, and Spain, and they have a state, and that's because they have a distinctive language that's been standardized in some kind of way. Now, I'm not sure how accurate all of those things are, but that's what he says in the work. So this located between the transnational Latin, which is dominating scholarly intellectual endeavors, producing what people have called the Republic of Letters, where people can write to each other across the vast space of Europe and use the one same language, and the subnational dialects, of which there are so many in Italy. However, he doesn't finish this book. As I said, in book two, he abandons it. And I think what he does is he moves from a theory of language and language change into the Divine Comedy, which he writes for over several years as he's exiled until his death in Ravenna. And he writes the comedy, as he called it, it was called Divine by other people after his death, in Italian. And in the course of doing that, he changes from theorizing to performing what he's theorizing. And I think that makes him a radical kind of modern language planner. And I'm going to justify that in a minute. So what's interesting about this is, and though he's often considered the father of language nationalism, he's actually very cosmopolitan as well as a patriot. He loves his country, which he sees as Florence, rather than anything else, and from which he's about to be exiled. But he sees no contradiction in loving the world and other cities, even if he criticizes what he calls their ugly or corrupt speech. He also criticizes people who are too focused on their own national culture or their own literature or their own city above all the others. So he emerges as really quite contemporary in today's age. Now, I'm going to give you this quote from book six of the Vulgari Eloquentia. Of course, it's in Latin. I've given you the Latin in the first, in the headline. And this is the English translation from Stephen Bottrill. To me, however, the whole world is a homeland, like the sea to fish. Though I drank from the Arno, the river of Florence, right, before cutting my teeth, and love Florence so much that because I love her, I suffer exile unjustly. My judgment more reason than sentiment. There is no more agreeable place on earth than Florence. In the pages of the volumes of poets and other writers by whom the world is described, and when I reflect inwardly on the various locations of places in the world and their relations to the two poles and the circle at the equator, I am convinced that there are many regions and cities more noble and more delightful than Tuscany and Florence, and many nations and peoples who speak a more elegant and practical language than do the Italians. Now, that's an extraordinary statement for someone who's been accused of being a nationalist. So what is the national and language connection all about? Norman Davies, in what I think is one of the best books written about European history, describes Dante's work as the reasoned advocacy for the vernacular. What he means is that instead of just saying the vernacular is more important than Latin, as some other texts that existed at the time, because Dante wasn't the first person to say these things, he actually reasons it. He puts a case, an argument, logic, evidence to the extent that he could. According to Norman Davies, this makes Dante the father of modern European literature. And it's interesting to draw the line here, because we can't just see language define nationalism in the way we understood it, how the nations of Europe were created from the 19th century onwards with one language, one nation ideologies, which has sometimes been called the European tragedy. But in Dante's vision, it's actually very different from this. We have to conclude that Dante was opposed to monolingual nationalism, even though he never explicitly says that, so far as I can tell. The one country, one language ideology is an invention of the 19th century, when unique national languages and struggles to make states conform to the boundaries of language, which of course they never did and they never can. So given all this, what kind of language planner is Dante and how unique is he? Well, I'm not claiming that he's the first person to think about language or to theorize about it. We can find language theorizing in Sanskrit from Panini and other great grammarians in ancient India. Many debates about language there with many contestants. Aristotle wrote extensively about language, and there's some definite evidence of influence from Brunetto Latini into Dante's view of language. In fact, there are some bits in the DVE where he talks about nature abhors a vacuum, and that's a clear quote from Aristotle. There are rhetorical studies about how language can be, how some people are more persuasive in language than others, and how you can develop this in Sicily, in Rhodes, in Athens. The Stoic philosophers gave a central place to philosophy, to language in philosophy, etc. So there was a lot of this. There was also language policy in India. I've written a little bit about this in the 3rd century BCE. Ashoka, the Indian emperor, the only Buddhist emperor of India, produced multilingual policies, not actually advocating multilingualism, but using multiple languages. There's a stele in the museum in Kabul that actually proves this, including with Greek on it. Then Qinhuangdi in China took the opposite direction. Instead of promoting pluralism, he promoted political unification through the standardizing of the characters. So, you know, these are really ancient examples of language policy outside of Europe. Vietnam as well, I've looked at them in the Temple of Literature in Vietnam, which go back to the 10th century and prevailed in this big struggle around Chinese characters, French romanization, that is writing the language in Latin characters through French, etc., which prevailed until the defeat of the French and South Vietnamese at Dien Bien Phu in 1954. So there were also in Europe vernacular studies, such as the one that I quote there in Ireland, defending Irish against Latin, or in Bulgaria, Church Slavonic against Greek and other languages. So these defenses of the vernacular were not unique to Dante, but none of them did what he did, which was to develop an explicit theory of the vernacular and criteria for language planning. Also a process for how to bring about planned language change. That's why I think he becomes a language planner, given that that's my professional area. I'm particularly friendly to him on this. And also, as I said, the coexistence of different kinds of language. Other than Ashoka in India, all of these others were efforts to produce only one language and make it prevail in a particular area. So he may be the father of European vernacular nationalism, but he's certainly not a narrow nationalist. I think we can call him a cosmopolitan and a patriot. Now, this thing that I've been talking about called language planning, what is it? Well, I mean, it's a huge area. I'm not going to talk too much about it, but just to say that it's an effort in academic scholarship, but also in practical life to solve language problems in society. One of the great scholars and pioneers, Einar Haugen, a Norwegian-American, did really important studies on how, also based on a poet, famous Ivar Arsen in the 19th century, who went through all of the dialects on the amazing coast of Norway to establish what he thought was the purest non-Danish form and build the national Norwegian language from that. Others looked at immigrants in the United States. Joshua Fishman's work was on that. And many of them looked at newly independent Asian and African countries becoming independent and freeing themselves from European colonization and how they would create a national language or unify their countries, either by rejecting the European colonial language or by accepting it, but by giving it a place alongside local ones like India has done. And the one I'm mostly going to talk about is the individual mentioned at the bottom, Jiri Nelstupni, who talked about language planning as combining cultivation and policy. I'll get to him in just a minute. There are some ironies in the questione della lingua. This is the language issue that came out of a large part of Dante's work. Because as I've said, he inserts the political into the literary, but it wasn't that started the language question, because I'm going to say why in a few minutes. It gets going 2 centuries later in the work of Pietro Bembo, Le prose della vulgar lingua, and in these other people, it gets turned into an ideal in which Dante is one of the crowns alongside Petrarch and Boccaccio. And these people mostly argued the supremacy of high literary, mostly Tuscan, which really was what I said before, the performance of this planned language that Dante himself did. And as Ugo Foscolo said centuries later, l'italiana è lingua letteraria fu scritta sempre e non mai parlata. A literary language always written, never spoken. Well, that's not what Dante saw, but nevertheless, one of the reasons why young people in Italy today can read much older prose than you can if you're an English speaker trying to grapple with Shakespeare, who's centuries later, is because for a much longer period, Italian wasn't actually in its standard form a spoken language, but a written language, and written language changes much slower. So in the DVE, Dante hunts around and finds all these 14 varieties and describes them. And he's wondering how you can produce an illustrious language out of these to give that middle level between the dialects and the transnational Latin. And he comes up with 4 criteria, I think makes him an almost modern language planner, and no one else that I've been able to see from before the 20th century did anything like this. The first criterion was that the language and the changes you make to it should be illustre. In other words, people should be proud of it. It should be eminent, enlightened, and dignified. Very importantly, it should be cardinale, meaning the cardinal points. If you choose a variety from one language, it should point the dialect towards other norms. Now, if you look at the way Hebrew was revived in 19th century Palestine, or how Tagalog was developed into Filipino in the 20th century and other languages, this is a large part of what they did. They chose forms of language from, and what Ivar Aasen did in Norway, from particular dialects. They choose particular lexical forms or grammatical forms which they think are exemplary and allow you to generalize into other forms and point towards new national norms. So lots of research to pick generative changes. It should be aulicum, it should be official and appropriate for governance. And this is very interesting because, you know, one of the great innovations of Joshua Fishman and other people in the 20th century in the United States was to describe language as being domain specific, that it varies according to the settings in which it's spoken, and that these variations are predictable and standardized and very, very much a part of how we learn and use languages, with register differentiation as well. Now, aulicum means that a language, this middle language, should be appropriate for governance. But very importantly, it wouldn't be appropriate for the home. What Dante wants to do is to preserve locutio primaria, the first language, the dialect, for the home and the heart and the family and the city and the town. This language we're talking about now, the national language for the state, and then locutio secundaria, grammar or Latin, for international work. So this is a very modern contemporary image. The early pioneers of language policy, as I've mentioned already, were trying to solve very practical problems in the world, and they came up with a scheme. None of them, and I've read these works and I've met most of these individuals, none of them cite Dante at all, but these works from Haugen and others talk about a new country selecting a language or dialect, which they then elevate into a national code. And this selection is usually done by some military general or a prime minister or somebody who forces it down everyone's throat. That's normally how it happens, selection through force. And then you codify this through this selected code being standardized in dictionaries, grammars, registered norms, et cetera. In the Tagalog Filipino case I gave, this was called intellectualization, and probably the most sophisticated example of this that I've ever seen. Really quite remarkable work done by Sibayan. Then it's elaborated into different domains. So it can be used. One of the important things that had to be done with Hebrew in the 19th century, it was a religious liturgical language. It had been spoken in synagogues and used in synagogues for real, you know, millennia. But you couldn't say to someone, "Pass, you know, I'd like a cup of coffee," or "I think I'm going to cough." It wasn't for ordinary speech. And so this elaboration takes the language into ordinary domains, specialist domains, nuclear physics. You elaborate it into different domains, so you give it a whole range of expressive power. And this means finding appropriacy rules and norms for it. And then it's cultivated, and it's cultivated mainly through literature, through usage, through normalization. There's modern forms of cultivation. Just think of the way African-American forms of speech through jive and through rapping have taken off in the world. You see kids in Thailand or Melbourne or Milan who are influenced by these forms of ordinary speech, and they do this through modern day social media influence cultivation, whereas in Dante's time, of course, it was done through literature. So as you can see, these reflect quite a bit, not completely, of course, but quite a bit of Dante's innovation. So I think his claim, I make this claim on his behalf as a great pioneer of language planning. This is the gentleman I mentioned before, Jiří Novštupný, who was a Czech professor who came to Melbourne and set up the founding professor of Japanese at Monash University. He was a great Sanskrit and Latin scholar and as well. Wonderful individual. I worked with him a bit, and he and a Swedish scholar, Björn Jernud, did a lot of early pioneering work and on language policy. And he came up with a distinction that I think suits Dante's work very well. He said that language change can happen through politicians, government officials, or experts who are appointed to solve language problems or impose a language solution on people, but also by poets, writers, and cultural figures. They cultivate language and develop models which then other people follow, and this cultivation model sits alongside policy. And my claim is that Dante did both of these things. He cultivated through the Divine Comedy and established as one of the, you know, innovators in the Questione della Lingua in Italy, established as the canonical literary norm of Italian, but he also did it in policy theory and policy in the DVE, which is not very well known. But one of the reasons why nothing got anywhere was because of this, and it seems terrible to mention a pandemic in a pandemic in the world's most locked down city, but it's true, there was this horrendous pandemic, of course, the most fatal in history, perpetrated by that person pictured on the right, Yersinia Pestis, who killed up to 200 million people in North Africa, Asia, and Europe. But because Italy was a large trading nation, you know, through Venice and Genoa and other places, it was particularly hard hit. And Dante's beloved city, it hit after his death, of course, some, you know, almost 20 years, not quite after he died, but Venice is not that he ever returned, he died in Ravenna, was reduced from 120,000 in 1338 to 50,000 in 1351. So this immense loss of life. I've taken some slides out. I can talk about the Guelphs and the Ghibellines and the papacy and the Holy Roman Empire and the politics of things there. It's very, very interesting in relation to Dante's life, but I think it would have been just too much. So I'll go on. So the Black Death, the bubonic plague, devastated the cultural, political life and social life, economic life of the Italian cities, as of most of large parts of the world. And so the planning of Italian fell to the hands of others, and eventually they created l'Accademia della Crusca, which actually uses some ideas from Dante. Crusca means chaff. I think they probably get this from Petrarch more than from Dante. But anyway, in the DVE, he's got these references to the process of planning. And you can see the image they've got there, which is the chaff. And you put wheat in, and you, or other, you know, similar grain agricultural things, and you put them through this sieve type thing, and it removes the wheat, the husk of the wheat, and throws away the husk, the crust, the chaff, which is la crusca in Italian. So the purpose of this Accademia was to remove this chaff and leave only the beautiful flower inside. The image of the academy as doing this is not really accurate anymore, because it has a much more contemporary understanding of language than is implied in that name. The French Academy still tries to do this, but the Italian Academy, which is the oldest in the world, is no longer strictly focused on purity, although it has its puristic moments here and there. So I think that's my case for Dante as a language planner. And now I want to link this to Italian and Australia. I'm going to go through this quickly. I'm just going to tell you that if you're interested, you can buy a book or get your library to buy a book that's just about to be published. It might be just published already, actually in Florence by Franco Cesati Editore, and edited by Nina Rubino, Anna Rita Tamponi, and John Hajek, called, it's a bilingual text, Italian Australia Perspectives and Trends in the Teaching of Italian Language and Culture. It's going to be released as part of the Settimana della Lingua Italiana, and I've got a chapter in there as well. So what is Italian looking like here? Well, it has two lives, really, and they're contradictory to each other. It's declining in our homes, but holding on and even prospering in schools. Since the 1980s, work by people like Nina Rubino and others showed that there's increasing anglicization, meaning that even in second generations who speak Italian, a lot of it is already anglicized, either in their syntax or forms of expression or phonology or in other ways. There's also significant language erosion in the second generation, and unfortunately, despite Dante's efforts, continuing negative attitudes towards the dialect compared to the standard. Of the figures underneath there, we really should only just focus on the last one. I've got a table about that in a minute, but I'll just show you that it's declining deeply at the home level, with home usage of 0.7% of the whole population. That's still very large. It's about 1 million people in Australia, but it's declined significantly. So about 1 million, or more than 1 million people in Australia have connection to a home, not usually their own home, but it's their nonna's home, where Italian is spoken. And when I say Italian, I mean either standard Italian or a dialect. I think we should stop having negative attitudes to dialects. It's ridiculous. And this happens within a very special feature of Italian as a world language, which is it's mostly an immigrant language, with its two vast historic migrant outflows. Look at those incredible figures. From unification in 1861, 1870, when Rome is reestablished as capital, to the 1920s. Actually, Rome's not established as capital in 1870. To the 1920s, there's a massive emigration, and most of this leads to language loss. It's mostly dialect speakers and peasants who leave, although there had been, we know, one of the great outflows of Italian population in the centuries before was cultural figures, singers and painters. You just have to go to St. Petersburg and you see the incredible number of architects who designed many of the great buildings of that city. Or even in Bangkok, the throne room of the royal palace and the head of the main culture university founded by an Italian emigre. You find similar things all through the world. The incredible number of Italians at the Chinese court as painters in the Min and Qing dynasties, a huge emigration of artists, scholars deeply into France and Spain and England. So before this mass migrant outflow, there had been centuries of artistic and cultural outflow. But this was a proletarian outflow of ordinary poor people leaving because Italy could offer them no jobs. 29 million people, one of the greatest movements of non-forced migration, although poverty is a kind of force, of course. About 10 million of these return and about 18 million settle abroad. And of this group, this was the period of the greatest Italian-American migration, produces the nearly 30 million Italian-American population of today, many of it mixed marriage, of course. But other great sites were, of course, Argentina, Brazil, and Uruguay. In the US, they encountered massive Americanization campaigns, not them, all immigrants, and of course, this led to strong language loss. And in Argentina, Brazil, and Uruguay for a time, and Argentina also almost adopted Italian as the official language of so many. And in parts of Brazil, you still have entire towns where huge numbers of people use Italian all the time. But in these countries, because of the proximity of Portuguese and Spanish, language shift is easier because they're so close to each other. So unfortunately, the language went backwards in all of these places, though many, many, many thousands of people learn it in these societies and are recovering their Italian citizenship. And then there's been a third wave, the second wave to Australia in the 60s and 70s, which with other immigrant communities produced our official policies of multiculturalism, and the third wave since the crisis of 2008. So as you can see in the bottom figure, nearly 4,700,000 in 2015 Italian residents abroad. The difference in this third wave is that these are speakers overwhelmingly of standard Italian, not a dialect. I'm just going to speak very quickly about these next two slides because I want to finish soon and take some questions if there are any. How do these waves and this history interact with our histories of teaching Italian? I think that there are three histories. I actually have mentioned these at a talk I gave on Italian in Adelaide a few years ago. First, the foreign one, which really didn't involve Italian speakers, even if they are migrating. The first presence of Italian in Australian education, as it was in Britain, was its prestige status that came really from its presence in literature, as it was appreciated by so many of the great British writers, many of whom were Italian speakers. Just look at the incredible influence that Italian language and themes and topics had on Shakespeare. 16 of his plays are either situated in Italy or have strong Italian themes, either from antiquity or in contemporary terms. So there was this Italian Italomania in the 19th century, which coincided with unification. You know, when Garibaldi died, I think it was as many as 10,000 people gathered at the Sydney Town Hall to acknowledge him in a tiny city like Sydney was at the time. So this was an acknowledgement of the literary, artistic and cultural prestige of Italian culture, not of it as a country, because it had barely existed as a country, wasn't an economic force in the world. The second one was the one that was produced, which I call the demotic, which came from the migrant diaspora, in which many people experienced a lot of prejudice and racism and repudiation for the way they spoke. And yet through their participation in the multicultural movement, with Greek Australians in particular, we're in the forefront of generating this official multiculturalism, which we retain in Australia today, and of course, which continues to develop and change as new groups come in. And then the projected identity, or this new history, which is what we have to imagine the future teaching of Italian. And here I think Dante in DVE teaches us something important, not the poet, the language planner, the poet as well, but certainly the language planner, because there are these changes. Italy deeply enmeshed in Europe in an official and converging Europe, and Australia more and more enmeshed in Asia. So this divergence actually suggests a growing away, but in fact, geography at this time in history is less important than it ever has been. So we have well over 1 million Australians who've got some connection with Italian language. They're either Italians living in Australia, Italian Australians, or non-Italian Australian Italophones, people who speak Italian but have no Italian ancestry. Italian is very prominent in the cultural life of the society. And in education, it's incredibly prominent. It shares popularity with Japanese in schooling. Although Italian is stronger at the primary than the secondary level, Japanese stronger at secondary than primary. In Victoria, for example, Italian is more or less equal with Indonesian at the primary level in numbers and schools. And if we aggregate all these levels and include recreational and adult programs, it's possibly the most studied language in the country. And yet at home, as this analysis of the 2000 will be interesting to see the census we've just done a few weeks ago, but this is the last available major one, we can see this significant loss in the homes and this very unfortunate and actually incorrect heading from the ABC, number of people speaking a second language at home. Well, it's not the second language, home language or mother tongue. But as you can see, all of these languages, Italian, Greek, Croatian, Polish, and Maltese, declining quite sharply. I'm just going to return to the DVE and then finish. One of the best analyses, I'm going to try and make a connection to the centre here because I know it's a centre for equity in education. There are connections which I haven't drawn out because it would just take too long. One of the most appealing studies I've read about the DVE is from a French study in which they identify something that's very different from the way French language planning has developed. A strong focus on eloquence. A lot of what Dante is saying there is about eloquence. What he means by this is that if you have eloquence linked to rhetoric, in other words, if you're able to speak well, it gives you a certain kind of power in the world. It's a power that's cultural, but as we see in the work of Bourdieu and Bakhtin and Gramsci and others, eloquence also has material benefits. Eloquence and rhetoric and persuasion are forms of cultural power that can be converted into economic and material change and opportunity in the real world. Now, Dante mostly meant this in writing, but it's also true here and there that he thought about it in speech. And this interesting study by Imbach and Rosier Katak from the French school at Rome concludes that in the DVE, Dante was oscillating, moving between stressing the one to the many and the many to the one. So they see in him what I see in him too, this pluralism, this multiculturalism. And they use this idea to interpret the theory of language coexistence or multilingualism in DVE. And they compare it to other people in Europe at the time who are pushing for more Latin, like Roger Bacon, who sees even English people as us Latins. But Dante imagines vernaculars share the space of communication with Latin, and this is radical. He also sees that you can create an illustrious vernacular, that is a national language, from the vernacular spoken, and this is original. And what's really radical is he offers a method for doing so. He also expands identity. He did not imagine a nation as nationalism, but as a community of communication. That's the terminology that I use, borrowing from Wright. We too should think of language and culture and language and rights as promoting, extending, pushing further what I like to call world-mindedness. I think it should be our main objective in schooling, even in language programs teaching one language like Italian. We should use his spirit to move the civic, ethical, and human cultural responsibilities into this sense of global citizenship. He saw it as Fiorentini, Toscani, Italiani, Europei, cittadini del mondo. I think that's very clearly the pattern. We could see it as Adelaideans, South Australians, Italian Australians, linked to Europe, linked to Asia, linked to the world, cittadini del mondo, and aware and conscious that we are on Aboriginal land. So the possible lessons from the DVE for Italian teaching today: respect dialects, but ask yourself, are they really dialects? They're not really dialects of Italian, as we call them. They're actually separate languages that co-evolved with Florentine. They're sister languages of Florentine. We should respect traditions, admire communication, see language use in the same way he did, as creative and dynamic. We don't have to go along with all his judgmentalism, but we can still see, as he did, that we can be changed by learning other languages and change the world by doing it. We could think of the identities of students. There's some parts of the DVE that do amazing things expressed in ways that would be strange to modern readers, but if you think about it and read different interpretations of it, it's very clear that he is thinking about forms of diversity. In diaspora communities, we can do this, we must do this, with the multiple communication influences on the lives of children. We should think about an experiment with forms in exactly the way he did. He's got a literary text written in Latin in which he's talking about the revival and creation of dialects that are not actually dialects, as he often says himself. We could expand identities without erasing them. And we could link to other cities and Vulgari just as our students do, just as he did. So I'll leave it there. I hope there's time for questions. These are some of the references that I've used, and I'll unshare the screen.
Thank you very much, Joseph. That was a very, very interesting presentation. I think I might stop the recording now, and then we can take some questions from the floor. Is that okay?